said, I believe that God is wanting to extend. I believe that God is wanting to spread our impact over this valley in a greater way. Now you say, well, that sounds self-serving. No, I want to see more people touched by the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to see more people come to the Lord. I believe that's what we're about here at this church. That is the main focus, that we are to introduce the lost to Christ. We're exalting God. We're training and nurture believers. I want to do that in a greater capacity, not merely in this city, but across this valley. Now can I get an amen? And then to make demands on the capacity or resources of that. And as I said, if we're going to stretch to what God would have us to be, then it's going to make demands on our resources. Can I get an amen on that? Now, the first week we talked about stretching out our past. The fact we talked about the staff, that God wants to use our past to help us accomplish the victories of our future, and not to be afraid to pick up your past to be able to use it against the enemy. Can I get an amen? Last week we talked about stretching to receive. You've got to stop allowing the enemy to stand between you and what God has for you. We talked about the lame man, the man with the withered hand that stretched forth his hand to receive. We talked about the woman with the issue of blood who had to press through the crowd and stretch to touch Jesus. I don't want to just be in his presence. I want to touch him. Today I want to finish up this series and give you the third part, taking you to an Old Testament story about how God worked through the prophet Elisha. I've entitled this last one, Stretch Yourself. Turn to somebody and say, stretch yourself. Now come on, turn to them and say, stretch yourself. Now the scripture reference for today, and we're going to walk through this story, that's why I want you to have your Bibles open, is 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. I wish I had time to read the entire story, so I encourage you to go home and read the entire story of how God worked through this Shunammite woman. Now, let me just briefly give you a synopsis of the story of what is happening. It talks in 2 Kings chapter 4 that there was a Shunammite woman, that she was a woman of high regard, a very successful woman. She was married, and here she found that the prophet Elisha, not Elijah, but Elisha, the predecessor of Elijah, would come through her area. And he would stop and visit as he was ministering. And so she told her husband one day, she said, listen, he comes in and we don't have a hotel in this town. And he always needs a place to stay. And we've got the means, we've got the ways. Well, why don't we build him an extra room? We've got a place we can build a room onto the house here. Let's build a room. Matter of fact, we'll put it up on the second floor. That way it'd be nice and cool, the breeze that would come through. And so let's build a room for him, a place that when he comes and visits here in our town, that he'll have a place to stay. We'll furnish it real nice, a nice bed and table and candles so we could stay up at night and read and meditate and everything. And so when he comes, so that's what they did. They sacrificed, they made the effort, they built on a house so that when Elisha would come, he would have a place to visit. And so there she was blessing that man. Well, when she did that, and he was so surprised at this, him and his servant Gehazi, that when they revealed this to him, this is what we're going to do, he basically said, well, what can I do for you? How can I be a blessing to you? And she said, well, you know, I really don't need anything. Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, said, well, listen, she doesn't have a son. She didn't have any children. And, of course, you can recognize what that meant in that day and age. And so with that then in mind, here's what Elisha said, 2 Kings 4:16. He said, about this time next year, everybody say about this time next year. About this time next year, Elisha said, you will hold a son in your arms. You may not be able to see the blessing of God today, but turn to somebody and say, about this time next year. I like what Nate said today. It's coming. God's blessing and God's miracle is on the way. How many are ready to receive that? God's blessing, God's miracle is on the way about this time next year. And sure enough, God gives her a little baby boy. So we have that little baby boy, and the baby grew up. says in verse number 18, the child grew and one day he went out to his father. So apparently now he's an adolescent or young teenager, 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. He's able to go out to the fields by himself. So he goes out to his father, who is a reaper. So he's out working in the field. And when the boy gets out there, he starts complaining to his dad, "Dad, I've got a bad headache. I've got a severe headache." Well, all dads know what to do when your kids come to you with a pain. You know what to do, don't you? You send them to their mother. That's what you do with them. And that's exactly what he did. He said, "Well, you need to go back to your mom. Go back to your mom. She knows what to do. She'll take care of you." And so the boy goes back to his mama. This miracle child goes back there, sits in his mama's lap. So apparently he was still pretty young. He sits there and literally dies in his mother's arms. Headache gets so severe that by noon, the Bible says that the little boy was dead. So what did the mom do? Here's this miracle child that she had, and the boy dies. So what does she do? 2 Kings 4:21. She went up, she said, and laid him on the bed of the man of God, then shut the door and went out. So Elisha wasn't there. She had built this room up there for him. Now, she was a well-to-do person, obviously, or they wouldn't have the ability to build an extra room for the man of God. So if they're building an extra room, I'm sure that each one of them had their own. What I'm saying here is I'm sure that this little boy had his own bedroom. But the mom did not take him and lay him on his bed. Where did she take him? Come on, I just read it for you. Where did she take him? She took him upstairs to the man of God's room, laid him there on that bed that she had provided for the man of God. Now, I want you to think of a principle here in this. She had prepared that room. Her and her husband had prepared that room, had sacrificed, had paid for that. In other words, her sacrifice became the seed for her miracle. When the little boy was dead and she says, "I need a miracle," she said, "I know where to take him. I know where I have given. I know where I have provided. I know where I have been obedient to God. I'm going to take him and lay him there on the prophet's bed." Her sacrifice became the seed for her miracle. The place of her offering was about to become the place of her miracle. I want that to sink in. The place of her offering was about to become the place of her miracle. She laid her need on her offering. I'm slowing down now because I want you to sense this. I never really had seen that before. She went up there, but I thought, wait a minute. This is what she built. This was her offering to the prophet. This was her offering to the work of the Lord. This is to say, this way I want the prophet, when he comes, he don't have to worry about a place to stay. I want him to be able to do the ministry that he does. So we're going to provide that for that, and we're going to pay for that. Your offering becomes the seed for your miracle. Now, I'm not saying you give to get. I'm not saying that you have to buy the blessing of God. But I read throughout the Word of God that when we give, look how the gospel came to Cornelius' house. In the New Testament, in the book of Acts, Cornelius is the Gentile that God used to bring the message of the power of the Holy Spirit into the Gentiles. What does it describe Cornelius as? He was a man who gave alms. He was a man who gave, even as a Gentile, gave to the Jewish to see the temples were built. Your giving opens a door. Your giving, or I should say it this way, opens a window. And when your need comes in your life, and it is going to come, can I get an amen? I don't know what your need is going to be, but I guarantee you your need is going to come. I'd a lot rather that when my need comes that I have a place that I can go and take my need. I have my offering. I have my faithfulness and my giving unto God. They say, "God, I have been faithful unto you. God, I have been a blessing unto the work of the Lord. God, I have done what you've told me to do. I've got a place to lay my need at." Man, that's good. And as we're going to read in the rest of the story, that's where God worked the miracle. is there on that bed. And so I know some of you have been worried. You ain't taking the offering yet. Oh, yes, I am. I want the ushers to come forward right now. Because I wanted to declare the word of God to you in this truth. Some of you are missing the opportunity for God to work in your life. Now, again, when she built that room, she was building it out of blessing. She had no need. She said, oh, one day I'm going to have a son, and that son's going to die, and I'm going to need a place. No, she didn't look to that. She merely said, I want to be a blessing. I want to be sure that the work of the Lord through the prophet is not hindered in any way. And I'm going to look at what my means and my ways are that we can provide to that. And she told her husband, here's what we need to do. And that's a pretty sacrificial gift. That's a pretty big gift. If you're going to build an addition to your home to exclusively be used for the sake of the gospel, that's a pretty big gift. Can I get an amen? And so this was not a small thing that she did, but it was something that was within her means. I want to challenge you today, because if we've talked about stretching, if we're going to do what we need to do, it's going to have to stretch us in the area of our giving. Now, many of you over this summer have been doing that. You have been stretching, and I've seen that. But there's still some of you today that I believe God is wanting to challenge. And he brings this part of the story today to show you that God wants to prepare a place that he knows your faithfulness, not by your words, but by your actions. And that when those needs come, then with confidence, you know that you can bring them before the Lord because of your obedience to him and because of your faithfulness to him, that you know he will be. She took that boy and placing there on the bed of the man of God. So we're going to receive. Put the five ways to give up there real quick. I know I'm getting you out of order here. But I want to challenge some of you today. I want to challenge some of you today to give sacrificially. And give it your tithe, 10% of your income, your offerings. We say that every week. But when you do that, then when your need comes, and it's going to, because we're all going to face needs in our life, then it is with confidence that you know where to take that and where to place that. She laid her need on her offering. I want to have a place to bring my need. And I believe that if you'll do that, just as we're going to discuss in the rest of the story, you're going to see the miracle working power of God. Even when you don't understand, even when you can't see it happening, you know you've laid down the principle, you've been obedient to that. Matter of fact, I'll just say it this, and I felt this so strong during the worship that I went to the message. I hadn't intended on doing this, but God really spoke to me that there's some of you needed to hear this word. That you're not preparing a place for God to be able to work. He says, you bring the tithe into the storehouse, to the church, and I will open up the windows of heaven, and he'll pour you out a blessing that you'll not be able to contain. What unlocks that window? What prepares that place, if you will? It's your giving. Well, I didn't expect you to run the aisles on me. I didn't expect you to be this dead, but I didn't expect you to run the aisles. See, again, that's just a lie of the devil to try to restrict us and tell us that, no, we can't do that, we can't do that. And God says, no, if you will be obedient to me, I want to make a place. I want to build that platform of faithfulness so that then when the need comes into your life, then you've got a place to bring that. And I'll open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. I don't know who God's speaking to this morning, but I'm telling you that God is wanting to do something in your life. God is wanting to do something in the area of meeting a need. You're not even aware of the need yet. But if you'll be faithful to God, you're preparing that place for that to happen. How many will receive that word? Say amen. We're going to receive our offerings. You've got the different ways to give there. You can text. You can go online. But some of you, just like this, said to her husband, we got to build that room. Her husband was in agreement with it, obviously. We've got to build that room. We've got to give. And I think some of you, God has been dealing with over the last month or so about really doing something out of the ordinary. And I want to challenge you today, do it. God's getting you ready for something. God's getting ready to do something in your life that is going to be a miracle, but it's not going to happen until you prepare a place for it. Let me pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord God, that you have been so faithful to us. And now, God, we've come today to be faithful to you. God, we want to be used, God, to see individuals touched and changed by your gospel. Just as the Shunammite woman and her husband said, we want to give to help the work of the Lord through the prophet Elijah. God, I believe there are people here today been so faithful to you, Lord God, that say, I want to give so that we can make more room for the work of the Lord to go through Cornerstone. So, God, speak to us today. Fear be gone. Provision be provided. And I thank you for the obedience of your people. And everybody said, amen. All right, the ushers are going to receive, and I'm going to go on preaching. Because I know you can do two things at once. Can I get an amen? So again, so here she is. She takes her boy up, and she places him on the bed of the prophet. Goes up there and lays her need on her offering. Then what did she do? Verse 22, she called her husband and said, please send me one of the servants and a donkey so I can go to the man of God quickly and return. So she got on the donkey. She rode as quick as she could to go out and meet Elisha. When Elisha saw her coming, he sent Gehazi, go out there and see what's going on. Verse 26, so run to meet her and ask her, are you all right? Is your husband all right? Is your child all right? And when he got there and asked that, she replies, everything is all right. Or I like the way the King James puts it, it is well. Now, wait a minute, things aren't well. The boy's laying dead on the bed. Her heart, no doubt, is broken. But her response was, it is well. Is well. This was not a statement of the present. It was a statement directed to the future. And when our times of need and crisis come, what we have got to do, we've got to learn to speak not out of the circumstances, but speak out of the faith of what we believe God is going to do. Let me put it this way. It was not a statement of the outward circumstance, but it was a statement of her inward faith. Do you speak in reaction to the circumstance around you, or do you speak in reaction to the faith that is within you? Now, I'm not saying that don't deny that you've got problems. Don't deny that things are happening. I've seen people that they're cold, and they've got a cold, and they're sick, they're sneezing. How you feel? Oh, I'm feeling great. Liar, you're not feeling great. But I know that my God is a healer. And I'm not going to allow my circumstances to be the thing that dictates my emotions. I'll say that again. I'm not going to allow my circumstances to be the thing that dictates my emotions. I'm going to stop living in the defeat of the present and start believing for the miracle of the future. Oh, yes, I know there's situation. I know it's bad. I know it doesn't look good. But I know in whom I have believed, and I know that he's able to keep that which I've entrusted to him. She said, it's all right. Verse 29. Elisha said to Gehazi, all right, so here's what we're going to do. Tuck your coat into your belt. Take my staff in your hand and run. Don't greet anyone you meet. If anyone greets you, don't answer. Lay my staff on the boy's face. So Elisha again tells Gehazi, go take my staff and lay it there. Now, what did we learn in our first week? That the staff represents our past victories. The staff then represents that diary of the things that God has done. And we talked about picking up our past and letting the devil know that God has been with us. And if God's been with us, God can do it again. How many remember that? Amen? But it was Gehazi. It wasn't Gehazi's staff. It was Elisha's staff. And Gehazi gets there and lays the staff on the boy. And what happens? Nothing. lays that miracle staff, that staff that God had used over and over again, lays it there and put it on the boy, and nothing happened. Why? Because it wasn't Gehazi's staff. It was Elijah's staff. Secondhand past experiences are not enough to face current crises. Secondhand past experiences are not enough to face the current crisis. Oh, the good old days when God used to do that. And remember, my mama used to tell me, and my grandmama used to tell me, and remember, that's wonderful, and I thank God for our past. I thank God for our heritage. But what happened yesterday is not going to get me through today. It's going to encourage me. Other people's experiences will encourage me, but it will not empower me. And many times that was a great sermon, Pastor. God's really working. You hear this story of what God's doing. And I thank God for that, and I celebrate that. But again, it's not going to be secondhand experience. It's not going to be somebody else's staff. It's got to be what God did in my life. But more importantly, it's got to be what God is doing in my life. So what did Elisha do? When Elisha realized that, verse 32, when Elisha then came into the house, there was the child lying dead on his bed. Let me give you some of the things that Elisha did. First of all, he came into the house. When you want to see miracles in your life, when you need that which was dead to come back to life, you need to come into the house. I'll say it again. When you need a miracle in your life, when you need that which is dead to come back to life, you need to come into the house. This has been something I've been saying over and over again. I'm amazed that when things go bad in people's lives, then they stop coming to church. Well, something happened, difficulty happened. Well, Pastor, we got some problems, but when we get that right, then we're going to be back. Dummy, dummy, dummy. You are playing into the hands of the enemy. When Elisha realized what was happening, he said, I got to get in the house. There's a reason the scripture says when two or three are gathered together, oh, you can serve God I can just serve God at home. I can watch the people on TV. I can have my own prayer time. You can do that, honey, but you can't be the church at home. I'm going to say it again, whether you shout it or not. You can watch TV. You can have your Bible studies. You can pray. You can have that personal relationship with God. But you cannot be the church. And there is something that happens that can only happen when two or three are gathered in His name. And my goodness, if two or three can make something happen, imagine what 1,000 or so can make happen. He came into the house. Forsake not the assembling yourself together. And he says, especially as it gets worse out there. How many know it's getting worse in our world? If there ever was a time you need to come to church, it is now. Jesus said, I will build my home Bible study. I will build my home television. I'll watch it on YouTube, Jesus said. Oh, thank God for all those resources. Don't misunderstand me. But there is something that happens when you come to church. He says, I will build my church. That's the ecclesia, the called out ones. We are called with a purpose to reach this city with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's not going to happen with just one person. That's going to happen when all of us fulfill the calling of God. He went into the house. What did he do next? Verse 33, he went in, shut the door. Everybody say, shut the door. He shut the door on the two of them and prayed to the Lord. He shut that door. It was just him and the boy there. And if you're going to see miracles happen in your life, if you're going to stretch, let me tell you, there's going to come a time that you commit yourself to the house of God, and there's going to be a time that you're going to have to shut out the distractions. He said, no, you guys stay out here. I'm going to go in with the boy. And he shut the door behind him. You've got to shut the door to not only just the distraction of this world, but shut the door to the negative influences that are around you. You're hanging out with the wrong crowd, going to the wrong places, listening to the wrong stuff. I thought somebody would help me out today. And as long as you're doing that, you're not going to see the miracles happen in your life. When Jesus raised a little girl in his ministry from the dead, he went in, shut the door, and just took a select few of his disciples in with him. You need to put the naysayers, the negative, you need to put those that are all the time gossiping and this and that, you need to put them to the outside. You need to come in and say, I'm going to get with God. God's about to do something in my life, and shut the door. Somebody say, shut the door. So then what did he do? Verse 34. Then he got on the bed and lay on the boy, mouth to mouth, eyes to eyes, hands to hands. As he stretched himself out on him, the boy's body grew warm. This is unique. The boy's laying there on the bed, dead. And so Elisha comes and lays out on top of the boy. Just lays out on top of him. Now that seems kind of weird, doesn't it? Oh, come on, somebody help me. Why did he do that? You know why he did it? Because that's what his mentor, Elijah, did. If you go to 1 Kings chapter 17, Elijah raised a boy from the dead. Elisha would have been there with him when he did it. And it says in verse 21 of 1 Kings 17, he says, then he, that's Elijah, stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried out to the Lord, Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him. So again, Elisha would have seen this. And so here he is, oh, wait a minute, I know what this, I remember this story. I remember this lesson. I got to go in there, and that's what Elijah did. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to lay out on him. You can't just do it because somebody else did it that way. And if we're not careful, we become creatures of habit. And just because we did it that way last week doesn't mean we're going to do it that way this week. It's going to take a fresh revelation of what God's desire and what God's intent was. The sons of Sceva saw this in the New Testament when Paul had been casting out devils, and they said, oh, we know how to do this. And so they came up to a demon-possessed man, and they said, in the name of Jesus, who Paul preached, in the name of Paul, we cast you out. And the devil said, we know who Jesus is, we know who Paul is, but we don't know who you are. And too many times we get in a ritual that this is the way that we've always done it. That's the way we've always done it. Elijah did this not because of the direction of God. He did it because of the tradition of the past. I don't want to live by the tradition of the past. Just because we did it that way 10 years ago doesn't mean it's going to work today. Because in the great words of the prophet Bob Dylan, the times, they are a-changing. And I want to be a church that never compromises the word of God. This will not change, but I'm telling you, the way we do things will change. Fifteen years ago, we didn't have these. We didn't know any way how to use these things. Well, now we know how to use it. 15 years ago, we were on TV. Now we're blasting across YouTube, and we're getting to everybody's home anytime you want it. Before, you had to wait till 8 o'clock on Sunday morning to watch us. Now you can watch us anytime you want to. You got access to it anytime. And I know those of you who are out there playing on your phone during church that you're just watching last week's sermon. I know that's what you're doing. Do y'all know I can see y'all out there? I didn't know if you knew that or not, but I can actually see y'all out there and see what you're doing. No, they said, that's the way we've always done it. Now, when Elijah laid his body on this boy, it says that the body became warm, but there was no life. Now, why was the body warm? Why did suddenly this body that didn't have any life in it and was growing cold, why did this body all of a sudden start getting warm? No. It was taking the heat from Elijah's body. I mean, if I've got a cold thing and I put it next to me and I'm warm, I'm going to warm that thing up. Can I get an amen? And so really, really what this was, it was just because of the proximity time. Proximity to Elijah. Too many times we rely on short-term experiences. It feels good as long as we're in his presence. But when we leave his presence, the chilling effects of sin come back on us. We come to a church service and we feel the presence of God. Man, that's good. I felt the power of God. I was warmed by the power of God. Yes, but you were not transformed by the power of God, because when you went back outside, before you even got to your car, you was cussing your wife out. I can see what happens in the parking lot also. Come on, somebody help me now. And God doesn't want you just to come in here and get warmed by him. He wants you to be transformed by him. You feel it in the church service, but you leave and you feel the effect of sin coming back on you. So what did Elisha do when he realizes that this ain't working? This boy ain't coming back to life. He's warmed up, but I don't want warmth. I want life. I don't want just the experience. I want the transformation. So what did Elijah do? Again, verse 35, Elijah turned away and walked back and forth in the room. Now, it doesn't give us the insight into Elijah, but I can imagine what he's thinking. He said, wait a minute. Elijah did this, and the boy came back to life. I did it. And nothing happened. What's wrong here? But Elisha was smart enough to say, I know who the source is. I got to talk to God. And Elisha got up, and I like this because I like to walk and pray. He just started walking and praying. He just walked to and fro, and he's calling out to God, and he's seeking God. He's saying, I got to know what's going on here. In other words, Elisha prayed, and he made it personal with God. If you're going to experience the resurrection power in your life, it's going to take a personal encounter with God. It's not going to happen because of someone else's past experiences. It's not going to happen because we've always done it that way. It's going to take you. Everybody say you. No, let's say everybody say me. That was less of you that said me. Everybody say me. It's going to take you. It's going to take me seeking God. It's going to take a personal encounter with God. Not just getting his presence. We talked about that last week. Not just getting close to Jesus, but touching Jesus. Where Jesus said to Peter, I know what people say about me. Who do you think that I am? You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said, flesh and bone did not reveal that to you. You've had a personal encounter. God the Father has revealed that. You know who I am. God, once again, give us a personal encounter with you, one that it's not religion, it's not tradition, it's not just going through the motion, it's not just coming to church and feeling blessed. It is something that changes our lives. It's the revelation of who Jesus Christ is, the one who died for us, the one who rose again, the one in him that we have life. So after that, after he prayed and realized that, he says, now I know what I got to do. It's verse 35, Elijah turned away and walked back and forth in the room, then got on the bed and stretched out. Everybody say stretched out. Stretched out on him once more. This time it's different. This time it had meaning when he stretched himself. Real ministry will always take proximity. What I mean by that is you can't do real ministry from afar. It's only going to happen when you get engaged, when you touch where the need is at. To bring things back from the dead, to bring life back into a situation, that means you're going to have to stretch yourself out. Everybody say stretch. It may be uncomfortable, it may not be convenient, but your stretching is what it's going to take to bring the miracle. So what was the result? Verse 35. The boy sneezed 7 times and opened his eyes. I find this kind of unique, that the way that God did it, he just didn't just jump up, say, I'm alive. He sneezed. Not once, not seven times. Now, a sneeze is when you expel a bunch of stuff at a high rate of speed. And here's what I find that God starts doing in our life, that when the life of God starts coming back into us, there's some things that are going to come out of us. No, I'm not saying you're demon-possessed or anything like that. Although some of you I'm a little concerned about. But there are things that we have placed within us that need to come out of us. Our attitudes that get bad. The things that the enemy has lied to us about and held us down. Those things need to come. He sneezed that and then he opened his eyes. And the boy came back to life. You read the rest of the story and Elijah called for the mother. The mother came in. The mother came down and worshiped and was very thankful to Elijah for what had happened and took the boy. And so it ended in a miracle in his life. But it didn't happen until he stretched. Now here's what I want to tell you today. Past experiences will not do. Some of you had great past experiences. Some of you can say, boy, at one time I was really on fire for God. Some of you have been used greatly in this church in different ministries. But past experiences will not do. First of all, you need to come into the house. Some of y'all have been dancing around on the perimeters. Everybody say, I love my pastor. It's time for you to come into the house. Now, when you come into the house, can I get an amen from all the parents here? When you're in my house, you're going to live by my rules. Come on. you walked into that one. I'm slamming the door behind you. Why do we not think it's that way in God's house? Why do we not think that when you come into his house, we're going to live by his rules? So you can't live by past experience. You've got to come in the house. And when you get into the house, when you get to that relationship, you got to shut the door. You got to cut out the distractions. You got to cut out the negative influences. You got to cut out those things that you know is robbing the life out of you. You can't do it just because you've always done it that way. Not tradition, not religion. No, you're going to have to get in proximity of what God wants to do in your life, and you're going to need to stretch yourself. You're going to need to stretch yourself. But one final thought, and then I'll be through. But you can't ever forget. Your stretching is not about you. Your stretching is not about you. Elisha didn't need the miracle. The boy needed the miracle. Elijah was just fine. He was out doing his thing. The boy needed the miracle. The boy was dead. The boy was laying there. The boy needed that. The family needed that. The mom needed that. The dad needed that. They needed a miracle. And can I tell you today, there are dead people that we encounter every day. Dead in their sins. Dead in the confusion of this world. The life has gone out of them. They're laying there dead, and they're just waiting for us to stretch ourselves to touch them. Oh, we can be the comfortable church. We can come in and have our worship, and we can experience, and we can get all warm and gooey and feel the goosebumps, and that's wonderful. But that is not what touches a dying world. God's not called us to be an ordinary church. God has called us to be a supernatural church. God has called us not to just mourn the dead, but to bring them back to life. But I'll tell you today, that is not going to happen until we stretch ourselves. Can I get an amen? Pastor Rudy, be Jesus. Come here, be Jesus real quick. Alex, come here and be the lost guy. Jesus right here. Lost guy over here. Stretch one more. to step out that way. All right? Jesus reached to the lost guy. Lost guy reached to Jesus. We have a gap here. This is somebody's son. This is somebody's father. This is a brother that's lost, that is out there. Jesus reaches to them, but what he told us to do is to go into all the world. We are to be his hands extended. So what am I going to do? I'm going to get a hold of Jesus, and Jesus is going to get a hold of me. Oh, I felt that. Now, okay. And me and Jesus can have our own thing going. Whoop, hallelujah. Whoop, I feel the power. Yes, oh, glory. But no matter how much I jump and shout, he's still lost.
That's right.
He's still in his need. He's still dead. It's going to take me, it's going to take you stretching to reach out. And church, until we stretch ourselves, we are not going to see the dead come back to life. Because you see, they don't know where to go. So they got a mama. They got a daddy. They got a brother. They got a sister. They got somebody who says, oh, please, Jesus, please, can you just send somebody? I don't want my son to be lost. I want my daughter to be lost. I don't want them to be lost. Please, can you just do that? And Jesus says, I look out over the harvest and it is white. It's ready. But I don't have anybody willing to stretch. Because I got to get home before the ball game starts. I can't stretch because, my goodness, we're going to go on vacation and I need that money. I can't give. Oh, you got quiet on me there. We say, oh, God. And so God sends somebody then that gets a hold of Jesus, and Jesus gets a hold of them, and they're ready, and we get ready to stretch, and we say, oh, no, don't send that person. I don't like the way they do it. Send somebody else. Oh, don't you think that happens? When you're drowning, when you really want to see your son or your daughter or your brother or your sister, whoever, when you really want, you don't care who God sends. As long as they send somebody. Come on, church. God wants us to stretch. God wants us to stretch. God wants us to stretch ourselves. Elijah laid out. Oh, proximity. It ain't going to smell good. It's going to be uncomfortable. But when God wants to use you as a conduit for his power to see the dead come back to life, that's how many of you know, how many of you were brought back out of death into life? And I'm not talking about physical death. I'm talking about spiritual death. Oh, I wish somebody would help me here today. I wish you'd just take that pride off for just a minute. I wish you would just let the devil know that you haven't forgot where you came from. You haven't forgot what Jesus did when he reached out to you. But honey, I guarantee you, it wasn't just Jesus. God sent somebody. God sent a brother or a sister. God sent somebody to stretch out and touch you. Then why won't we stretch? Thank you, guys. Why won't you stretch? Because we get comfortable, because we get complacent, because we're happy where we're at. And church, I'm just challenging you. God wants to stretch you. He's wanting to stretch you so that you can reach more people for him. Bow your heads with me all over this place. Here's, first of all, it takes a personal encounter with God. Some of you are here today and you say, Pastor, I'm more like the dead boy than I am the prophet. And the enemy has come to kill, steal, and destroy, and you know that your life is not where it should be. Literally, you're miserable. And you say, Pastor, I want that life. It takes a personal encounter with Jesus. Not what your mama's got. Not what the preacher's got. Not just because that's the way we've done. It's going to take a personal encounter with Jesus. And if you're here today and you don't know him as your Savior, God's stretching to you. Jesus is stretching from the cross of Calvary and saying, if you'll call upon me, you can be saved. Your life can change today. But you've got to reach back to him. So I'm going to pray in just a moment. If that's you and you say, Preacher, my life is not where it should be. My relationship with God is not what it should be. I'm lost. Caught up in tradition. I caught up in all the other stuff. I need a change in my life. I need Jesus. And if that's you, when I get through praying and say amen, I'll just ask you to raise your hand. I won't embarrass you. I just want to pray for you. But let me tell you really who I'm preaching to today. I'm preaching to Christians that have grown comfortable. Christians that have grown complacent. Christians that can tell you more what's wrong with this and that than the opportunities of what God can do through them. God is ready to stretch you today if you'll stretch out. If you'll stretch yourself, you can't begin to imagine how God is going to use you. And so that's the second part of what I call for today. Those of you who recognize I need to engage more. I've been blessed. My God has blessed me. I shouldn't be here today, folks. I shouldn't be here today. I should enjoy the blessed. I do not deserve what God has blessed me with. I never want to forget that. But I want to stretch to reach others. I want to get outside my comfort zone. And so if that's you here today, when I get through praying and say amen. Now let me do it this way. Let me change my order here. Let me pray for those who need Jesus first. Father, thank you for what's about to happen. Thank you for men and women, teenagers, young people that are here today that recognize they need you. They're sick and tired of being sick and tired. They're ready for a change in their life. They're like the little boy. Their life literally has gone out of them. They're lost. They need you and they want you. You love them and you care for them and you reach out to them. You stretch from the cross today to them. And all they've got to do is stretch back. Thank you. Thank you for men and women that are going to raise their hand and say, I want Jesus. I need a change in my life. I'm lost and I want to be found. I want to come home to Jesus. In Jesus' name, heads bowed. Nobody look around. If that's you and you say, Pastor, that's what I want. I need Jesus in my life. I need to make that change. If that's you, right now, slip a hand up. Come on. Slip a hand up. Hands are going up. Come on. I'm waiting on you. More hands are going up. Yes, thank you. Thank you. You got to stretch. You got to stretch. More hands. More hands. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. sir, you got to stretch. Put your hands down. Everybody stand. Give me my prayer team here at the front. I believe you meant business. I'm going to ask you to stretch again. You raised your hand today. Then I want you, as this worship team is going to sing just through one time, but you raise your hand. I believe you meant business. Maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you say, I need God in my life. I need prayer in my life. If that's you, then I want you just to step out as they sing one time. Just step to the nearest aisle. He's the way maker, and he'll make a way for you. Step to the nearest aisle. You raised your hand. Come on, come on.